coming to you live from the Conversation Room, deep in the heart of the Central Valley. This is the Almond Man Podcast, hosted by the one and only Russell Harris. Are you ready to get nuts?
And I've been taking care of business every day. Taking care of business every way. I've been taking care of business. It's all mine. Taking care of business and working overtime.
All right, everybody. Thank you and welcome to the Almond Man Podcast. And we're in the Conversation Room today, and we happen to have Jerry Dyer in, which I take it a great honor for you to be on here, Jerry. And how you doing, buddy?
I'm doing good, Russ. Thank you for having me on your show, your podcast. I appreciate the invite.
Shoot. Hey, I haven't seen you in about 3 or 4 months. You look good.
Losing a little weight. You know, they shut down the gym, so you got to work out in your garage now with a Bowflex or whatever.
Yeah? Well, you look like you're doing it. Yeah. Hey, so I'd like to get people that maybe don't really know Jerry Dyer, who they are, because I really, you know, haven't known you till I met you about 3 or 4 months ago, and I understand you're a Valley boy, so, you know, why don't you, where were you raised in sure. high school and all that stuff?
So I was born in Fresno and lived southeast Fresno for about my first 5 years, and then my dad decided to buy a home in Fowler out in the country. And so we moved to Fowler, and that's where I started kindergarten, went all the way through high school there, played basketball, football, baseball, loved sports, and then graduated and ultimately ended up became a cadet, a police cadet in Fresno PD. But, you know, it was my dad that got me interested in law enforcement, even though he didn't start out in law enforcement. My dad grew up without a father.
Oh, wow.
Lost his father when he was about 5 or 6.
Jeez, that's tough.
Yeah.
That'd be tough.
And he grew up in a rough environment in Kiowa.
Where's Kiowa?
Kiowa area, you know, south of Roosevelt High School, all of that
area.
Oh,
all right, okay.
So he went to Roosevelt, had to drop out his sophomore year, and started working 2 jobs, construction, and later on driving truck, and eventually put himself back in school, got his high school diploma, and then later in life he decided, after working 2 jobs all of his life when he was, I think, in his late 30s, early 40s, decided to go in law enforcement. Sent himself through the police academy.
How old were you in that time?
I was in high school, like my sophomore, junior year.
Yeah, to scare you a little bit, your dad becoming a cop, I mean, it's a dangerous job.
You know what? I'll tell you what swayed me. I used to see him come home from work after working construction and driving truck, and seeing the look on his face of being tired.
Mm-hmm.
Then I saw him coming home from work after being a police officer with a look of being excited.
Wow.
And making a difference. And that's what swayed me to change my initially I was looking at architecture.
Me too.
It, really?
Yeah, I was gonna be an architect or a baseball player or a farmer. So
yeah. I think you made the right choice.
I wasn't good at the first two. Architect, so you can draw, that's good. So
yeah,
anyways,
yeah.
Let's talk about you, not me.
No. Yeah, so I and then that's what got me interested in law enforcement. And I became a reserve police officer in Fowler Police Department at 18 years of age.
No
started,
kidding.
Started carrying a gun. And then
wow.
Later on, went through the police academy and got hired at Fresno, and the rest is history. Was there for 40 years, worked my way up the ranks, SWAT to narcotics, you name it. And then ultimately, last 18 years, I served as a police chief.
What was the first fight? You had to start at the bottom, obviously.
Oh, yeah.
Right, yeah, you started at the bottom. I don't know. Were you an assistant in a patrol car? I mean, how did that all get there? Took time.
Yeah. So you start out as a police cadet. That's not you don't wear a gun.
Right.
I went through the police academy first, which is unique.
Is that the Fresno Police Academy?
I went to, actually, at that time, Fresno's academy was decertified.
Oh, it was.
So I had to go to Visalia's Academy,
okay.
COS. Great academy. Graduated top of my class.
Wow.
First in the class.
You know, when you went
which
to
helped.
You know, I was at Fresno City, and they had a police academy. I didn't know it wasn't certified or nothing. But I tell you, those guys, you guys worked out like football players, not like baseball players. We're a little bit lazier than that. But football players, you had to run time laps and all that stuff. Yeah.
So
it's not an easy task. Some guys, I can't see how they even pass, honestly. Some of the guys there.
Well, some guys shouldn't. Let me just tell you right now, some guys shouldn't pass.
Yeah,
and then when they get hired, they forget all that, and they start eating too much, and they quit exercising. Yeah. They work too much overtime, and they let themselves go.
So you came at it in the 80s, I'm guessing.
I came on the department, went to the police academy in 79.
Okay.
Became an officer in 80. And, you know, worked my way up the ranks. I spent 5 years in patrols, an officer working midnights and lap shift.
Okay, when you're patrols, what was the greatest thing? I mean, you did great moments, and there's obviously some very scary moments. You've been there 5 years. I'm sure you have a couple that pop in your head, you know?
Well, the first 5 years as an officer, and then I promoted to sergeant, and so then I was still out in the patrol field.
Oh,
and
really?
Lieutenant, I was out in the field I wore a uniform my whole career, so it's, you know, there's some scary moments for us. So I've been involved in several shootings.
Wow.
You know, been shot at multiple times. Fortunately, never hit.
At least the bad shots.
Two trees saved my life, so I love trees.
Wow.
Where the bullets actually struck the tree. And then, those are dreaded moments.
Ah, man, I can't imagine.
But they're exciting when it's over because you survived it.
Yeah.
And, you know, unfortunately, a lot of guys don't survive those. But I was fortunate. You know, I was always big on training, fitness, staying in shape. Had to because, you know, the guys getting out of prison.
Tough
guys. And, you know, they have a respect level for guys that are in shape. And so, and there were some other, I mean, I can tell you, I was sharing the other day with somebody one of the moments I had where I ended up chasing down a suspect. This isn't one of my greatest moments, but chased down an auto theft suspect after a pursuit. Two of them ran from the vehicle. I ended up apprehending one guy, got on the radio, one in custody, and then I saw the other guy take off running. He was actually on a rooftop. So back in those days, you know that how the cars had the handles on them and the doors.
Yeah.
So I handcuffed this guy to the door handle, and I took off running after the other guy. And I told the units where the one suspect was handcuffed, and I couldn't catch the other guy. He jumped a few fences, but I thought, well, at least I got the driver.
Wow.
But when I came back, he was gone.
He was gone.
The handcuffs were dangling there. I guess I didn't slip them on tight enough, or he was double jointed. But embarrassing to have to get on the air and say, no one in custody. But we got him later.
That's a pretty good story.
Yeah. I don't like to share. I can't believe I just shared it publicly.
Hey, people make mistakes, man. It happens. Anyway, he's happy he got away. Yeah. Well, for a time being.
Yeah, I did. I enjoyed it. I had a vengeance for criminals. I loved to chase them down, foot chases, car chases. I had a burning desire inside to protect people. And arrest bad guys.
I was in Churchill, and I remember when you were always police chief, man. I mean, when you got on the radio, man, I always felt secure. You had it under control. You would talk with decisiveness and accuracy. It was pretty awesome.
Yeah, you know, people put their faith and trust in law enforcement to keep them safe because in today's environment, you know, that's the last line of defense, quite frankly.
Sure.
And I took that responsibility very, very seriously as a police chief. I spent many nights in the hospital with kids that were shot in drive-by shootings and saw the look in the parents' faces, held hands with them, cried with them, prayed with them. And those are the things, Russ, that drove me to make the decisions that I made in terms of how to keep people safe.
Yeah.
And so sometimes people would say, oh, you came on too hard, you didn't have compassion, and I used to tell people, you don't know what I've seen.
No.
That drove me to keep people safe.
You're a big man of faith.
Yes.
Big man of faith. I guess, are you Baptist, Catholic, Christian?
Christian faith, you know, and I gave my heart to the Lord, Jesus Christ, back in September 15th, 1991.
1991. I remember giving mine when I was 10 years old in 1973.
I wish I would have. Between 10 and the
It's harder to do when you're older because you got a lot more sins you want to give for. When you're younger, like 10 is a lot easier. So I compliment you. That means a lot, man. That's good.
Well, you
it
know,
changes your life.
I was at rock bottom in my life. I was separated from my wife. I'd been unfaithful. I was out drinking every day.
Yeah.
And doing things I shouldn't have been doing. And you get to that point, I was living in an apartment. My wife was at home with my daughter, who was like 2 years old. which will break your heart, right?
Oh, man, I walked those shoes, Jerry.
Yeah.
I don't walk them no more either.
And my son was like 6 years old, and he was living with me in an apartment. And I remember we were over at Peach and All living in an apartment. And I remember we were upstairs one day, and I looked, and my son was on the middle steps playing with these inner-city kids and having a great time. And I remember standing there looking back at my apartment. I said, man, I just gave up my house. I gave up all I had. I gave up my family. For what?
For what? Exactly.
And a guy invited me. I met a guy at a car wash. I was working narcotics as a sergeant. He ran into me at the car wash. And I remember he walked in, and we didn't know each other that well. But he looked me in the eye, didn't say a word, and he said, you need the Lord. And he invited me to church that Sunday, took my wife, called her up and said, hey, would you go to church with me? She thought I was, you know, playing a scam or whatever, because that wasn't who I was at that time. And I remember the pastor preaching on alcohol and adultery, the very things that
I was talking to you. He's talking to you.
And I, at the end of the service, the altar call was given, mm-hmm. and I grabbed my wife's hand. I said, let's go. I don't want to be a part of a church where they know all about you. And then I came back the next Sunday, same message, alcohol and adultery. Came back the third service, same thing happened. I left. And then
still talking to you.
Still talking to me, and that's the Sunday I gave my heart to the Lord, went to the altar and asked his forgiveness.
It's a decision, a big decision. And once you make that decision, you're a committed man. That's why you've been successful. Everything you committed to, you've been successful.
Yeah.
That's why they elected you mayor and won an election.
Hey, amen.
Didn't have to go to a runoff, okay?
It's commitment. It's commitment, brother. Whatever that commitment is in life, whether it's marriage or to your relationship with Christ or to, you know, holding a position like police chief or mayor, whatever, it's commitment, right?
Oh, yeah.
Or being a business owner.
Yeah, for sure it's commitment. Man, that's awesome. That's awesome.
Man, that was deep.
Yeah,
that was deep. I thought we were going to come on here and have fun and laugh. Now you got me telling my life story.
Well, that's what people would like to know. This is good stuff. The other thing I wanted to bring up, you told me when you were here one time that you put somebody in jail, and the guy asked you to protect. You had to protect his family, and how you went to.
Oh yeah.
You know what story I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do.
Can you share that with us?
Well, it was a story of, you know, oftentimes back then I was the president of California Police Chiefs, and I was doing a lot of prison tours at that time because of a lawsuit that was occurring. And I was doing it for the Governor Schwarzenegger at that time. And so I remember going to one prison in the South Valley. And I had pretty much carte blanche. I could go into the prisons and look at their facilities, their hospitals, everything. And so I remember telling the prison guard, the lieutenant, I said, hey, I want to go over to that pod. And he says, no, you don't want to go into that pod.
A pod? What is a pod?
A pod is like where you have a large area where a building where it's contained with gang members or
are they behind bars, or are they just walking around in a free room?
Walking around the free room, but they do have bars upstairs.
So you're walking, but if they wanted to get gang you up and beat you up real fast, they have the opportunity.
They could. And
I stay out of pods,
people. So I remember I told him, I said, I want to go in there. And he goes, no, you don't want to go in there. I said, no, I want to go in there.
I wouldn't want to go in there.
And he says, I said, why don't you want me to go in there? He says, because it's all Bulldog gang members. Vast majority of them you put in here, or your guys did, and they hate you. They hate you. And we don't want to create a problem. So I said, well, let's just go in there and take a look. So we walked in there. I remember there were these, it was very apparent, because Bulldog gang members, you keep them together. You don't mix them. And so there were all Bulldog gang members. I don't know how many there were in there, 150 of them.
No kidding.
Probably in the pod.
Wow.
They're down there on the room, you know, sitting on benches. But they had, it was two levels. And, you know, when I walked in, every head in that pod turned and looked at me. And
I bet.
And they knew who I was. Well, and because we were pretty tough on gangs.
You're hard not to recognize, Jim. You're hard not to recognize.
It was a shaved head. But and you could have heard a pin drop, by the way, Russ, when I
on the grass.
Yeah, all concrete, unfortunately.
Oh.
But I remember, you know, I looked around. I didn't talk to anybody. And then I was getting ready to leave, and we were walking to the door. The guy, you know, the lieutenant was a little bit nervous. He said, hey, it's probably time to leave. And I remember walking to the door, and there was a guy that came out of a cell on the top floor and on a landing. And he walked out, and he yelled my name. He said, "Hey, Dyer." Mm. I looked up, buffed out guy, shaved head, Bulldog gang member. And he said, "Thanks for protecting my family while I'm locked up." And it dawned on me right then that these guys have families. These guys have hearts. And when they're locked up, they're not there to protect their family. And some of their rivals.
Oh, can't imagine.
Might end up going and hurting their family. So they too rely on us. And oftentimes, I don't think police officers get the credit that they deserve because, you know, regardless of what your lifestyle is, cops protect you. If you're homeless, you're rich, you're poor, you're Republican, you're Democrat, you know, when you call 911, our dispatchers don't say 911, state your party. They say 911, state your emergency.
Yep.
And so we protect everybody. And I think sometimes, especially in today's environment, police officers getting a horrible rap, you know, getting accused of traumatizing kids and all these things. And that's not to say that, you know, we don't have some bad cops out there. We do across the nation. But by and large, I've seen heroic police officers out there day in and day out, keeping people safe, even gang members and their families.
Oh, yeah, for sure. I agree. Yeah. I think today's world's actually, I think it's a little ludicrous and crazy, personally. You know, I mean, a cop has definitely a harder job than he's probably ever had in his life. And because a few bad cops make all the good cops cause a lot more trouble. I can tell you one thing. Most people do not like cops when they get pulled over for speeding tickets. But yep. When they need an emergency, they call 911. They definitely need them. So exactly what you're talking about is...
I give you a good example, Russ. I had a phone call the other day from a guy. He's got a lot of influence in West Fresno. Black guy. Been in the gangs. Been locked up. Had family members killed by gang members.
No kidding.
And he's very involved in gang outreach. You know, I consider him to be a good friend.
Oh, wow.
And so... you know, when things are going bad, he's the guy out there intervening, trying to stop the violence. And so,
good,
you know,
for him.
We're getting all this pressure and heat in law enforcement about, you know, making traffic stops and, you know, being aggressive and all these things. And, we had a shooting that night where a gang member, a gang leader was killed. Later on, there was a 5-year-old that was shot in a drive-by retaliation.
Oh my gosh.
And so he calls me and he says, "Hey, we need some help over here." And he said, I remember he told me, he said, I said, "What do you think?" He said, "Bring back the old tactics." And so they recognize, and the old tactics, that just means having a lot of police officers in a neighborhood, you make traffic stops and you suppress the gang activity, right? And so it was interesting to hear that from him. But you know, the people that live in those neighborhoods,
they appreciate it.
They appreciate it. And we don't want to be an occupying force, never did, police officers don't. But at the same time, you gotta stop the violence.
So when you say to slow down the violence, you have traffic stops. You put a police car about every block, and as they come through, is that how you're talking about?
No, you're just patrolling neighborhoods and people that are driving through that, you know, on occasion they make some traffic violations or whatever the case is, officers are making traffic stops. And sometimes you don't have to make those traffic stops. Just be highly visible.
You're right.
But when you do make a traffic stop,
be ready.
There's always a potential for a confrontation. And that's what worries, I think, law enforcement today. They're afraid of that confrontation that gets captured on video. And not only can they get fired, but they can lose their freedom.
I know it's one big difference. I do speed now and then. I don't know if people believe it or not, but it's actually true. So I do notice when a lot of cops pull over now, when I was a young guy, they just walk up free and carefree. Now they walk up and they got their hand to the side because they don't know what they're walking to at any time, any place, anywhere.
Yeah. So you got to be, you know, you always teach train officers.
Safety.
Be careful.
Safety. Yeah. So retiring, how did you end up making that decision?
It was made for me.
It was made for you.
So in our retirement system, we have what's called the DROP system, Deferred Retirement Option Plan. And you can only do 10 years in that. So you get to be a certain age, you enter DROP, and then you can do 10 years. I timed out. I did my 10 years. So 40 years in the department. And honestly, I'd have probably, if it wasn't for DROP, I would have stayed. I would have stayed another however long they would have
had. Well, you're very good at it. I tell you that. Yeah.
But God opened up another door for me.
Mm-hmm. Now you're mayor-to-be.
Mayor-to-be, mayor-elect.
So there's got to – so you, as you were coming in, you were saying you were going to learn so much. I thought it was – you know, we shook hands out in the lobbying, and you're walking back, and he says, "How you doing?" He said, "Man, I'm just learning so much."
I'm learning things that I never thought I wanted to learn, but it is true. Being a police chief, I was over about 1,200 employees, $200 million budget. A lot of personnel, a lot of issues, a lot of things going on, litigation. But now in this different role of being the mayor, there's so much more to
it. How big is the budget in Fresno?
Well, with all in about $1.5 billion with your airports, transportation, that's general fund and enterprise accounts.
Wow.
The general fund's about right around $350 million. So general fund is what pays for parks, police, fire, some of those public works for the most part, although you get a lot of other grant monies that come in, federal dollars, state dollars, sanitation, for water, sewage, people are paying fees. That doesn't go into the general fund. That's called enterprise.
Didn't know. That's interesting.
Sanitation, for the sewer, for water, any of those things, the airports, it's an enterprise agency. Almost all of it. It is about 100% funded from revenues, like a business.
Right. I got that.
Yeah. So the other ones are more tax dollars, sales tax, property tax, occupancy tax. That's generally what makes up the general fund.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have the enterprise accounts over here from billings, revenue generators.
Mm-hmm. So when do you officially take office?
First week of January.
Ah.
Tuesday, I think it's January 4th. Is that right?
I don't know. I live in the country.
You don't have calendars?
Obviously not, because we missed our first podcast.
I know. That was my fault.
No, so, it's funny.
So January 4th, or I think it's 4th or 5th.
So you got to put forward a new budget and ideas, and all that's got to come from you,
yeah,
Mr.
You work
Mayor,
with
right?
Yeah, and you work with the council to do that. But,
And how many council members are there?
Seven. Seven council. They represent... So the mayor is elected at large,
yep,
for the entire city, and each council member represents a district. They're elected by folks in their district, and that council has certain responsibilities, and then the mayor has certain responsibilities. We have what's called a strong mayor form of government.
Okay.
So the mayor appoints the city manager. The city manager appoints all the directors, with the exception of the city attorney and the city clerk. That is appointed by the council.
Have you picked your appointees yet?
I have. I haven't made many of them public.
Well,
yet.
That you don't have to. I don't have to do it today. I didn't know this.
A new city manager. I'll be appointing three assistant city managers, and I have a chief of staff, government affairs, communications director, deputy chief of staff. So there's a number of positions that I'll be filling. Folks that. That
report
I'm comfortable
to you.
With.
Yeah, I know what they're doing.
Yeah,
you hope.
No, I got a. I'm hiring a city manager that this guy is already going 100 miles an hour every single day, 7 days a week. Emails at 11
Chip
o'clock
off the
at
old
night.
Block right there.
I love it.
That's good.
I thought on Sunday night at 11 o'clock we're exchanging emails. I know that's good.
That's really good. I kind of like my workplace. I always like to pick around people that think like me, or I hope to think like me, that are ambitious, that have the same goals and faith and good people, and hopefully it all works out. But everyone seems to make mistakes, and it always rises to the top, like for me and as will of you.
Yeah. Well, I'm a big sports guy, and I love sports.
You were a lot better than me, I'm pretty sure. I didn't win any awards at a police academy marathon run.
I saw your pitching form over there when you were in Little League. I thought it was right on.
I peaked at 10.
So you peaked at 10?
I peaked at 10. I dropped the five ball for Fresno State. You can ask me, like 24 of my friends out there. I only got one friend out there now. No, I'm joking. But so you take office, and how old are your children? You got kids, right?
I got kids. I got
grandkids or something.
Yeah,
no?
I got five grandkids, two girls, three boys.
Wow.
My daughter is a special needs teacher for Fresno Unified School
sweet.
District.
That's sweet.
She's 32. My son's 35. My son has a business called Big Bear Apparel. They do online specialty clothing.
That's probably picked up during COVID, no?
Big time. Yeah. He has a business here, and he has a business in the UK.
Wow.
The UK business picked up about 400% during COVID.
Awesome.
And the one here has picked up, I don't know, probably around 50%.
Well, that's still good.
So, yeah, it's good. It's his business has been good. And, you know, both my kids, children of faith, they married into married folks, children of faith, or people of faith. My my son-in-law is a police officer in Fresno, even though I tried to keep him out of that business for my daughter. And so my dad was a police officer. My sister, first female motorcycle officer in the history of Fresno. My niece was a police officer until this year. Her husband is still a police officer. And then my son-in-law is a police officer.
Wow. That's like all in the farming on my side. You're all in the police officing side. And that's, it's in the blood.
So you guys get around the dinner table. You talk about almonds. We talk about things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. yeah, nuts are very important, Jerry. yeah. So what I just want to ask one other question was, where is it? So look forward to get in there. COVID. Do you think COVID's going to have to be something we have to address? And I'm sure things are going to change. What's your opinion on COVID? And what do you think Fresno's going to have to do to address some of the future issues?
Well, COVID's real. I don't know at times if we've responded appropriately. I think there's been times when perhaps we've overreacted. And then there's been times, where perhaps there are certain places they underreacted to it. And I think it's natural because nobody knew.
No ways. No one knows.
Nobody knows, right? We don't have a crystal ball. But one thing I do know, it impacted a lot of people. My dad had it very bad.
Oh, wow.
And thought he was going to die. Told me on the phone he thought he was taking his last breath. But he's such
Was he hospitalized or ventilated or anything like that?
My dad would have to be dead before he went to the hospital. He's a hard hit.
Well.
He's recovered. But he had every single symptom. There was loss of taste, couldn't breathe, coughing, you name it. He had it all. And then it hit him, and then he started feeling better after about 5-6 days, then went out and started cutting wood.
And it got worse?
And it hit him back. Worse. So,
wow.
So COVID's real. It's real on our budgets. I mean,
who knows? I feel sorry for all the restaurant owners, because now they got to sit on the patio. But I think it's going to change how
Me too.
It's going to change every new regulation in buildings because you didn't have to air free flow. I'm thinking it's just a fact of life now.
Yeah, and you know what I hope, Russ? I hope that there's some takeaways that are positives from COVID, like you just talked about, more and more outdoor dining. I'm going to make sure that as a mayor of Fresno that we're going to have a much more business-friendly climate, an attitude of we work for you culture.
That's great.
So that when people want to relocate here, open a business, expand a business, that we do everything in our power to make that happen. And I'm hopeful that as a result of COVID, that attitude is going to be widespread throughout our city government. And I believe that has to happen because there's a lot of businesses that aren't going to be in business after COVID.
No.
And we got to figure out ways to help them be resilient, stay in business, or to get more business.
Well, hopefully they come with a vaccine and it'll take care of all that. Hopefully that happens. But, hey.
January. My prediction.
Hey, man, thanks for coming on today, man. It's been a great pleasure, and maybe I'll have you back on someday if you ever want to get on. And, great knowing you even better. You're going to do a great job. You can't please everybody. But anyways.
I appreciate it, Russell. And thank you for your support during the election. I'll never forget it, coming out here, having lunch with you, and supporting me financially. I'll always remember that and the good time we had here. And so anything you ever need, you give me a call.
Thank you, Jerry. All right, man. Almond Man Podcast, out.
Thanks for listening to the Almond Man Podcast, hosted by the one and only Russell Harris. Let's give a special shout-out to our producers, Gabe Camarillo and Grant Myers, and the team at Root Creative. Until next time, take care and prosper.